डियर स्टूडेंट्स, आई वेलकम यू ऑल एंड टुडे टॉपिक ऑफ डिस्कशन इज मैकल्स डायवर्टिकुलम। नाउ व्हाट इज मैकल्स डायवर्टिकुलम? इट इज अ ट्रू डायवर्टिकुलम बिकॉज इट कंटेन्स ऑल द थ्री लेयर्स ऑफ द इंटेस्टाइन। सो इट कंसिस्ट ऑफ थ्री लेयर्स of intestine. It is a true diverticulum and it is formed from the persistent vitelo-intestinal duct. So it is formed from the vitelo-intestinal duct. Usually this vitelo-intestinal duct gets obliterated during the normal gestation period, during the normal physiological process. But what happens here in 2% cases? So the incidence of Meckel's diverticulum is only 2%. So in 2% people, this Meckel's diverticulum is formed because of the persistent vitelo-intestinal duct that doesn't get obliterated. So that persistent vitelo-intestinal duct forms Meckel's diverticulum. So this happens only in 2% cases. The female and male ratio is male to female ratio is 1:2. So more common in females compared to male. And the clinical presentation is usually in the age, or the age presentation is common among the 2 years children or the 2 years infants. So this Meckel's diverticulum is only 2%, the incidence is only 2%, and the male and female ratio, that is the male is to female ratio is 1:2, and the age presentation, the commonly it occurs in the 2 years infants. Now the location, it is present proximal about 2 feet proximal to ileocecal region. Ileocecal region. So it is 2 feet proximal to the ileocecal region. Now what happens during the 4th week of gestational period? See, this is the gut. This is the gut, and this is the yolk sac. This is the yolk sac, and this is the gut. And this is the abdominal wall. So during the 4th week of intrauterine life or gestation period, during the 4th week of gestational age or the gestational period, during the 4th week of gestational period, there occurs a connection between the gut and the yolk sac. So there will be connection. This connection between the gut and the yolk sac is vitelo-intestinal duct. विट्लो इंटेस्टाइनल डक्ट यूजुअली फॉर्म ड्यूरिंग द फोर्थ वीक ऑफ गेस्टेशनल पीरियड. इट इज अ कनेक्शन बिटवीन द गट एंड द योक सैक. दिस लाइन आई हैव मेड, इट इज अ एब्डोमिनल वॉल. सो देयर इज अ कनेक्शन बट ड्यूरिंग द नाइन्थ वीक. नाउ इन नाइन्थ वीक दिस विट्लो इंटेस्टाइनल डक्ट विल गेट ऑब्लिटरेटेड. इट विल गेट obliterated. So in the ninth week of gestational week, this Whitlow intestinal duct will get obliterated. This is the yolk sac and this is the gut. Now, if this Whitlow intestinal duct remains, usually it gets obliterated. But in 2% cases, that is the incidence of Meckel's diverticulum is 2%. So, in that 2% cases, this Whitlow intestinal duct remains. So, if this duct remains fully, if the whole duct remains, so there is connection in the abdominal wall, there is connection between the abdominal wall and this connection, there is connection and the whole Whitlow intestinal duct is persistent. So this is known as the umbilical fistula or the Whitlow intestinal fistula. Umbilical fistula or Whitlow intestinal fistula. If the whole Whitlow intestinal duct is persistent, if it's remain, it doesn't get obliterated, connection is still between the gut and the abdominal wall. So this is known as umbilical fistula. But if some portion gets obliterated, but the proximal portion is still persistent, if it is still persist and there is some portion obliterated, but the proximal portion of the Whitlow intestinal duct is still persist. So this is the umbilical fistula. And if the some portion persist, there is no connection between the abdominal wall and the gut, but the proximal part of the Whitlow intestinal duct is still persist. This is known as Meckel's diverticulum. This condition. This is known as Meckel's diverticulum. It is 2 inches long. This is yolk sac. This is abdominal wall. And the proximal part of the Whitlow intestinal duct is persist. This is the proximal part of Whitlow intestinal duct. So the proximal part of Whitlow intestinal duct is still there. It is persist. It has not get obliterated. This is known as Meckel's diverticulum. Meckel's diverticulum. Now what will happen? This Meckel's diverticulum has cells. The cells are pluripotent. So this is Meckel's diverticulum. It has pluripotent cells. Pluripotent cells. These cells can further give rise to the different type of tissue. So these cells can give rise to 3 type of tissue. The gastric tissue, that is heterotrophic gastric tissue, or it can give rise to pancreatic tissue or to the colic tissue. Now, depending on the type of tissue which has formed in the Meckel's diverticulum, the function will be according to that tissue which has formed. So, if gastric tissue has formed, that will give rise to gastric acids and juices. If pancreatic tissue is formed, then there will be secretions of pancreatic juices and acids. Now, when this tissue is formed, there will be secretions of the juices and acids. So, if the gastric tissue is formed, there will be secretions of juices and acids. There will be then gastric ulcer. If the pancreatic tissue is formed, then there will be secretions of pancreatic enzymes, juices and acids, and that will lead to the peptic ulcer. So there will be peptic ulcer. Now this Meckel's diverticulum symptoms. Oftenly it is asymptomatic. There are no symptoms in many patients. But the typical features you will notice is per rectum bleeding. Per rectum bleeding. That is melena. That is lower GIT bleeding. That is lower GIT bleeding. Per rectum bleeding. That is melena. The upper GIT bleeding is uncommon. Besides this, as the food will get here, so that will cause stasis and obstruction. So food get well stuck, and that food will produce stasis and obstruction. And that will lead further to perforation. Because when there will be obstruction and stasis, that food will get accumulate, and then the proliferation of bacteria will occur at that area, and that will cause perforation. So that can lead to intestinal obstruction or intussusception. Intussusception. So intussusception and intestinal obstruction can occur there, and that can lead to the pain. Also the peptic ulcer formed will lead to the pain. Why peptic ulcer will occur? Because there will be intestinal obstruction and the food will block the area, and there will be proliferation of the bacteria, and the secretions, gastric secretions, the acids, the enzymes, that will cause acute Meckel's diverticulitis. Diverticulitis. Acute Meckel's diverticulitis. That is the inflammation there. That secretions, that acid will cause irritation and inflammation, and that will lead to the peptic ulcer and the pain in the region. So the pain will be there, and the very common feature is melena, that is per rectum bleeding. And there will be proliferation of the bacteria, and there will be intestinal obstruction. Now these were the symptoms. In investigations, we will recommend patient for the CT scan, for the ultrasonography, then angiography is not so good, but we will recommend, but it cannot visualize the whole area properly. Beside this, the small bowel enema could be given. Small bowel enema could be given to the patient if the mouth is widened. So, if the mouth of the diverticulum is widened, we can give the small bowel enema that can also visualize or can detect the Meckel's diverticulum. Now, the very good investigation recommend to the patient in case of Meckel's diverticulum is technetium 99 per technetate scan. Technetium 99 per technetate scan. It is very good investigation. So the 99 mTC per technetate is given intravenously to the patient, and then what will happen? It will localize the heterotopic gastric mucosa, and this radionuclide is taken up by the mucin secreting cells and the parietal cells. So this nucleoside will be taken up. This 99 mTC labeled per technetate is given intravenously to the patient, and this nucleoside will be taken up by the mucin secreting cells and parietal cells. So that cells, if present, that will help us that the Meckel's diverticulum is there. In treatment, we will go for the laparotomy, and we will resect. We will do the resection. Now, what we will do? The Meckel's diverticulum along with some part of intestine will be removed. For example, this is the intestine and the Meckel's diverticulum. These are the cells. So we will do what? We will remove this Meckel's diverticulum along with that adjacent intestine. So with the resection or the removal of Meckel's diverticulum, along with the adjacent intestine. This procedure is known as Meckel's divertilectomy. Meckel's divertilectomy, where the some part of the intestine, that is the adjacent part of the intestine to the Meckel's diverticulum along the whole Meckel's diverticulum, is removed.